Welcome to another audit walkthrough video from SuperfastCPA. I'm Logan, and in today's video, we're going to be going over audit area 3. This is section A3. This is an analysis topic, and it's perform procedures using outputs such as reports and visualizations from audit data analytic techniques to determine relationships, trends, or notable items in the data and identify the appropriate audit response. And we're going to be doing that the SuperfastCPA way, which is diving straight into the questions to learn the material. Now, if you don't know much about our strategies, make sure you go to superfastcpa.com and sign up for our free one-hour webinar training. Again, it's free, it is 1 hour long, and we will teach you in that 1 hour the key ingredients to passing the CPA exam so you don't waste months or even years of your time failing exams. Make sure you go check that out. And after you watch that, you're going to want to learn more, so make sure you also check out becoming a SuperfastCPA Pro member. SuperfastCPA Pro members get access to the full 10-question versions of these 5-question YouTube videos, so you'll be able to get a little bit more practice and a little bit more understanding if you become a SuperfastCPA Pro member and get access to those full videos. Now with that, let's dive straight into the questions. All right, here we are at question 1. And one thing I want to say about this topic, about this video, is technically any analysis topic is almost certainly going to be a sim, if not guaranteed to be a sim on test day. But, you know, in these videos, we are teaching through the multiple choice questions because it's way easier to figure out how to make a multiple choice question to teach a topic than it is to make a massive sim about it. So we are going to go through multiple choice questions, but look at this as an idea to help you understand how to, you know, apply this knowledge to a sim if you saw it on test day, because again, this is an analysis topic. All right, let's go into this. One thing I always like to do is I always like to read the last part of the question first, the last sentence, because very frequently that will give you an idea or give you context for what the question is about, so that as you read through the rest of the question, you can kind of be looking for what information you need to be able to get the answer. So let's read the last question or the last sentence first. Which type of visualization should the auditor use? Let's go up to the top. An auditor is analyzing the relationship between a company's advertising expenses and its monthly sales revenue to determine if increased spending on advertisements leads to higher revenue. The auditor wants to present the results of this analysis in a way that best illustrates the correlation between the two variables. So again, what type of visualization should the auditor use? So should they use A, a pie chart, B, a bar chart, C, a scatter plot, or D, a line chart? Now, based on what you might have learned in school or in just normal accounting, then you might already have an idea of what the best visualization is in this situation. But if not, that's okay. We're going to kind of learn what visualizations there are and when you would kind of want to use them in different situations and how they kind of relate to data analytics and data analytical procedures. So let's dive into the explanation for this one to kind of get started. All right, here we are. The answer is C, a scatter plot. So that's what we would probably want to use in this situation to show this in a visualization. So let's walk through this. This analysis is an example of a regression analysis, which is used to determine whether a relationship exists between two numerical variables. So if you want to show a relationship between two different numbers, like this number affects this number or something like that, then you would want to do a regression analysis. In this case, the auditor is examining whether changes in advertising expenses impact sales revenue. So we're trying to see if those are connected. A scatter plot is the best visualization for this type of analysis because it allows the auditor to see patterns, correlations, and potential outliers in the data. A regression line can also be added to quantify the strength and direction of the relationship. So you can kind of put a line through the scatter plot to kind of show the general trend that things are taking. But again, a scatter plot, and you've seen this before, you know, it's kind of a X and Y axis, and then you have dots that show where, you know, the correlation between two different numbers. That would be a great way to show this because then you would be able to see if the advertising expenses are higher, then the sales revenue is higher, or if it's not really connected at all. Now let's talk about the other choices and what they would be used for. Choice A, which was a pie chart, is incorrect because pie charts are used to show proportions, not relationships. And we've all seen a pie chart and it shows, you know, the percentage of the whole that is, you know, one demographic or one piece of the whole pie, whatever you want to say. Choice B was a bar chart. And this is incorrect because bar charts compare categorical data rather than illustrating correlations. And then choice D is a line chart. And we've all seen those as well. You know, it's kind of somewhat similar to a scatter plot, but it's like going from, there's a line drawn between each point to see how much it goes up between each point. This is incorrect because line charts are primarily used to show trends over time rather than relationships between two variables. So that, you know, line charts are more to show how things are changing over time, how they're going up and down, whereas scatter plot can be used to show the relationship, and that's what you would use for a regression analysis. Now with that, we learned a little bit about some visualization and a different type of analysis that you could use for data analytics. Now let's go to the next question. All right, here we are at question 2. What type of data analytic technique did the auditor execute? So let's go up to the top. An auditor is reviewing a company's accounts receivable to assess the reasonableness of the allowance for doubtful accounts. To do this, the auditor obtains a listing of all outstanding customer balances at year end and categorizes them based on the number of days past due. The auditor then calculates the total amount of receivables in each aging category to summarize the data and identify potential collectability issues. So again, what type of data analytic are they executing? What did they execute? Was it A, a predictive analytic? Was it B, a descriptive analytic? Was it C, a prescriptive analytic? Or D, a diagnostic analytic? Now, if you've heard of those before, then, or, you know, just kind of thinking of what the definition is of each of those words, you might be able to kind of figure out what kind of analytic they're doing in this case. But if not, that's okay. We're going to use the explanation to learn what kind of analytic is being done here. All right, here we are. The answer is B, descriptive analytics. Let's kind of jump into this and understand the different types of analytic techniques you can use. This is an example of a descriptive analytic, which focuses on summarizing what has happened within the data. You're just basically describing this is what happened. The auditor categorized and totaled outstanding accounts receivable based on their aging to provide a snapshot of the company's receivables at year end. So just showing this is where things are as of right now. This technique does not explain why certain accounts are overdue. That would be a diagnostic analytic, or predict future collectability issues. That would be a predictive analytic. Nor does it recommend actions to take. That would be a prescriptive analytic. It's just saying this is the current state of things, so that's why it's a descriptive analytic. So just to kind of reiterate that, let's go through the other options and talk about why they weren't the correct answer. Choice A, that was a predictive analytic. That is incorrect because the auditor is not forecasting future uncollectible accounts. They're only summarizing the current data. Choice C was incorrect because prescriptive analytics would be for recommending specific actions, which they're not doing here. And then choice D, that was diagnostic analytic. That was incorrect because the auditor is not analyzing why customers have overdue balances. They're just categorizing them. They're just showing these are the customers that are past due this many days, and these are the amount of customers that are past due this many days. So that's why it would be a descriptive analytic. But these different analytic techniques are going to be used with different visualizations to kind of show this information so that people can know what to do with it. If it's, again, if it's descriptive, you're just using it to see how things are right now. Or if you want to know what to do, you could use a visualization based on a predictive analytic to tell you this is what might happen in the future. You know, this all kind of fits together visualizations and different analytical techniques. Now that we've learned a little bit about that, let's go to the next question. All right, here we are at question 3. What type of data analytic technique did the auditor execute? So sounds like this is a very similar question, but let's see what the different scenario is. An auditor is assessing the effectiveness of a company's internal controls over payroll processing. The auditor compares actual payroll expenses for the current year to the budgeted payroll amounts and investigates significant differences to determine the reasons for the variances. Okay, so based on what we just learned in the previous question, I bet you could figure this out, again, based on what we just learned. So pause the video, think through these different options that are the same ones, so predictive, descriptive, prescriptive, or diagnostic, and try to understand or try to think about which one is the correct analytic being performed here, and then we will look at it together when you're ready. So come back when you're done. All right, here we are. The answer is D, diagnostic analytics. So again, we just learned about this, and a lot of the times you can kind of, just based off of what the word probably means, kind of guess the right answer just because diagnostic, you know, you're diagnosing, trying to understand what the cause of something, why something happened, you know, that makes sense. Let's talk about the explanation. This is an example of a diagnostic analytic, again, which seeks to explain why differences or anomalies exist in the data. The auditor is not just summarizing payroll expenses, but also analyzing why actual amounts differ from budgeted amounts by investigating significant variances. So again, this is a diagnostic analytical procedure to basically point out why something happened. Let's talk about the other ones. And again, we just went over this, so shouldn't be too difficult to remember now. Choice A, predictive analytics. That was incorrect because, again, they're not forecasting the future expenses. They're just explaining the deviations. B was descriptive. That was the answer for the previous question. That was incorrect because while, yes, they are starting with summarizing the payroll expenses, they are actually also investigating why those differences exist, which makes it diagnostic, not just descriptive. And then finally, choice C, prescriptive analytics. Again, they're not doing this to have recommendations for what they should do. You know, maybe they might do something like that after this, but currently it's just a diagnostic analytic because they're just trying to point out why there are these differences. All right, now with that, we learned a little bit more. Let's go to the next question. All right, here we are at question 4. Which type of visualization should the auditor use? Let's go up to the top. An auditor is performing a period-over-period analysis to compare a company's quarterly revenue for the past 2 years and identify any significant fluctuations between periods. The auditor wants to present the findings in a way that makes it easy to see revenue changes across different quarters. So again, which type of visualization should the auditor use? Now, based on what we learned in the first question and a little bit in the second and third question, you might be able to figure this out based on, you know, again, what we learned. So is it A, a pie chart? Is it B, a bar chart? Is it C, a scatter plot? Or is it D, a bullet chart? Which one of these visualizations would they probably use for this period over period analysis? Pause the video, think through this, and when you're ready, come back. We'll look at the answer together. All right, here we are. The answer is B, a bar chart. So that's what you would probably want to use in this situation for a period over period analysis. Let's talk about why. A bar chart, and again, you've probably seen this where, you know, there's the bars going up and down to kind of, you can kind of compare the size of the different bars. A bar chart is the best visualization for a period over period analysis because it effectively compares revenue across multiple time periods. So again, you could compare it like 2023, you could compare the bar of revenue for that to the 2024 revenue and see which one is bigger and see where the numbers are for that. It's a very easy comparison. Each bar represents a different quarter. I guess, you know, instead of a year, we could do quarter in this case, making it easy to see increases or decreases between periods. Let's talk about why the other options, of course, wouldn't be as effective. And we talked about this a little bit in the first question. So I think this is just a little bit of a review. Choice A was a pie chart. And again, pie charts are used to display proportions, like how much of the whole is a percentage, you know, how many people in the city drive this car or whatever. You know, we're just showing percentages of a whole when you're doing a pie chart. Then choice C, that was a scatter plot. That was the correct answer in the first question. That's incorrect because scatter plots are used to show relationships between two numerical variables, not period over period comparisons. And then choice D, that was a bullet chart. This is incorrect because bullet charts are better suited for comparing actual performance against a benchmark, not for period over period analysis. So again, we're kind of seeing here the different analytic techniques that you can use, the different visualizations that you can use, and why you would use them and when you would use them. We learned quite a bit, but now let's go to the next question. All right, here we are at question 5. Which statement best describes the difference between these data sources? So let's go up to the top. An auditor is performing data analytics to identify potential fraud risks in a company's financial records. The auditor reviews two different data sources. So they review a database of journal entries, including transaction dates, amounts, and account classifications. And they review email communications between employees discussing financial statements and reporting decisions. So again, which statement best describes the difference between these two data sources? So something a little bit different here, but this does relate to what we were talking about before, because, you know, you have to have data to be able to have a visualization and to be able to have the analytic techniques. So let's go through the options. Option A, both the journal entry database and the emails are structured data sources. Option B, the journal entry database is structured data while the emails are unstructured data. Option C, the journal entry database is unstructured data while the emails are structured data. Or option D, both the journal entry database and emails are unstructured data sources. So we're trying to understand here structured and unstructured data sources so that we can use them for our data analytics. Now, based on, you know, what structured and what unstructured typically means, you could probably think through this and know the correct answer. So pause the video if you need to, think about this, and when you're ready, come back, we'll look at the answer together. All right, here we are at the answer. B, the journal entry database is structured data while the emails are unstructured data. So let's walk through the explanation again. I think that just based on structured and unstructured, you probably could have figured that out. And so let's just make sure that you understand it fully here. Structured data is organized in a defined format, making it easy to process and analyze using automated tools. The journal entry database is structured because it follows a consistent format with clearly defined fields. So that'd be things like transaction dates, amounts, and accounts. You know, it's clearly defined, easy to follow, and it's structured. Unstructured data lacks a predefined format, making it more difficult to analyze using traditional data tools. Emails are unstructured because they contain free-form text that requires advanced techniques, such as text mining or natural language processing, to extract useful insights. So it's unstructured because even though, you know, emails typically have, you know, a format or something that you might do, they don't always have to have that. And it's all text-based. So people could say something completely different every single email. So it's a lot harder to pull data out of emails compared to a database. So that's why it's unstructured. Let's talk about the other options. You know, I think that we don't even really need to go over the other options because they're just variations of the correct answer. Understanding the difference between structured and unstructured data is important when selecting the right data analytic techniques and visualizations to interpret audit findings effectively. So you have to know what kind of data you have, which is, again, you know, structured or unstructured, so that you can then know what kind of techniques you need to use. And that would be things like descriptive or prescriptive or things like that, so that you can also know what visualizations to use to show your findings and to show the information that you have. Now, we learned a lot in these first 5 questions. Before we do anything else, let's do one more part of the SuperFast CPA process called pillar topics. Now, the idea behind pillar topics is as you're going through the questions to learn the material, you will notice the things that keep popping up in the questions. You've seen two or three questions trying to teach you the difference between a descriptive and a prescriptive analytic, or whatever the case is. Again, these are the things that you notice throughout the questions, and you pull them out as pillar topics, the most important things you learned, so that as you're doing this each day, you are pulling out the most important things you learned from the questions, and you're building your own personal repository of those things in your own words so that you are ready for test day. Let's go ahead and take a look at the pillar topics for this video. All right, here we are at the pillar topics. Let's just dive straight in. First off, selecting the right visualizations for audit analytics. Different types of visualizations serve different purposes, obviously. Scatter plots show relationships, and that would be something like a regression analysis. Line charts highlight trends over time. Bar charts compare categorical data, and pie charts display proportions. Now let's talk about understanding data analytic techniques. Auditors use descriptive analytics to summarize past data, diagnostic analytics to explain variances, predictive analytics to forecast future trends, and prescriptive analytics to recommend actions. The choice of technique depends on the audit objective. Now let's talk about applying audit analytics to financial data. Common audit analytics include trend analysis, and that would be evaluating financial patterns over time. Variance analysis, that would be comparing actual to expected values. There's regression analysis, and that would be assessing the relationships between variables. And period over period analysis, and that would be identifying fluctuations between time periods. Each provides insights into financial risks and anomalies, and you can tell those different kinds of analyses, you know, trend analysis or variance analysis, are connected to the audit data analytic techniques and to certain visualizations. You know, you can see here, you could probably use a trend analysis as part of your predictive analytics, you know, to kind of see what the trends are for future trends. And that would have to do with line charts. You would probably want to use a line chart there. So you can see how those are all connected there. Now let's talk about structured versus unstructured data in auditing. Structured data, and that would be things like general ledger transactions, financial statements, is organized and easy to analyze, while unstructured data, and that would be things like emails, customer complaints, even something like social media. Maybe you've seen something like that in the past. They might do social media forms or things like that that you can fill out. That would be, again, something unstructured. These require advanced techniques like text mining. Understanding these differences helps auditors choose appropriate data analytic methods. And then finally, the role of data analytics in audit decision making. Audit data analytics help identify trends, risks, and anomalies that inform audit procedures. Choosing the correct visualization, analytic technique, and data source ensures that auditors can effectively interpret findings and respond appropriately to risks. So with that, we've learned a lot in the first five questions and through the pillar topics. This is kind of a broad topic, a lot of different things that fall into this. And again, remember, this is an analysis topic. So most likely, if you saw something kind of around these lines, it would probably be a sim on test day. But again, we used multiple choice questions to learn this. But I think that based on what we learned, you could probably apply this to any sim that you see, especially if you're practicing sims on your own in your review course. Now with that, that is the end of the YouTube video. Thank you for watching. If you liked this, just remember that SuperfastCPA Pro members get access to the full 10-question version of the video so that they can get a little bit more help and a little bit more understanding. So make sure you check out becoming a pro member. And the easiest way to do that is actually by going to superfastcpa.com and signing up for our free one-hour webinar training. We'll teach you the key ingredients to passing the CPA exam, and it will give you a great path to becoming a SuperfastCPA Pro member. So check out the webinar, check out becoming a pro member. Again, if you like the video, make sure to like it and leave a comment. I hope this was helpful, and I will see you in the next video.